الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله رب السماوات ورب الأرض رب العالمين، وله الكبرياء في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم. الحمد لله الذي بنعمته تتم الصالحات، الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. ربنا لك الحمد حتى ترضى، ولك الحمد إذا رضيت، ولك الحمد بعد الرضا. صل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيد الأولين والآخرين محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، الملك الحق المبين، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله وأمين على وحيه. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد، واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. Dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, all praise and glory and thanks are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all that He has given us. وَإِنْ تَعُدُّ نَعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance and forgiveness and health and protection. In the next half hour or so, we'll inshallah practice what Muslims should practice always when we get together, which is التواصي بالحق والتواصي بالصبر. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. The ones that are not considered as losers are the ones who have faith and those who do good deeds. And then what do? They remind each other, tawasi. They remind each other of their duties, and they remind each other and they support each other to fulfill those duties. Because if you want to fulfill your duties in Islam, you need a lot of patience, and you need support. We need to support one another. As Luqman alayhi salam, when he told his son, Ya bunayya aqim as-salata, وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَانْهَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ. Oh my son, for establish prayer and promote that which is good and forbid that which is evil, and then be patient. وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَانْهَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ. And that's what many Muslims, they got it wrong when they thought that this is optional, and because it's going to bring a lot of headache, so why bothering? I will live a simple life by myself. I will not engage in anything, because interacting with people, engaging in societies, brings a lot of pressure and stress, and that's why it needs a lot of patience. And that's why Muslims who are fulfilling their mission, they need to remind one another continuously of their duties and obligation, and motivate, and then also support each other to fulfill those duties and obligations. The questions that we have been asking for so long, and we have been discussing, and probably for some of you, it looked like we are repeating ourselves. This question of why we Muslim ended up in this situation, why? I mean, you can take it as normal, but it is not normal yet. We shouldn't be in this situation by any means and by any measure. That's not the situation that Allah has chosen for us. That's not what we were designated for. So we shouldn't, because it has been there for a long time, it should not become normal, because it is not normal to be in this predicament when you have 1.5 billion Muslims who are largely marginal and almost irrelevant. You come to science, you don't see them. Discovery, you don't see them anywhere. That's not something that we should take lightly or we should accept. It's not because it has been there for centuries that we take it as normal or we accept it. We should always at least have the least level of iman, adhaful iman, which is to reject the situation in our heart that we know better and we should be better than this and we can be better than this. And we should work hard to find out what went wrong and how we can rebound and how we can fix this. So this idea of qada and qadar, and this is it, and there are conspiracy against Muslims, so we just have to accept that, that's not true. We are in the situation because of ourselves, because of what we have done wrong, and because what we have failed to do. And it is about time to accept responsibility for our reality and accept responsibility for changing it. Because things are not going to change by themselves, and things do not happen by coincidence. There are rules that are governing this universe. There are reasons why some nations progress and advance, and other nations and community lag behind. It is not by coincidence. And it is not because you are Muslim, or because we are Muslim, we expect things to work for us. It did not happen with the Prophet ﷺ and his community. That you don't have to do anything, Allah will do it for you. Why? Because we are Muslims. There is no such thing in Quran. Never. Allah promised us that we can relax and do nothing and everything will be taken care of. Never. إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. Or you believe, if you support the cause of Allah, Allah will support you. It's conditional. وَأُخْرَى لَمْ تَقْدِرُ عَلَيْهَا قَدْ أَحَاطَ اللَّهُ بِهَا. Things that you are beyond your power, beyond your capacity, these are the things Allah will take care of, not the things that you can do. So until you do everything you can, don't count on anything, don't expect anything, because you're going to be, and if we are not doing things right, and if we're not doing the right things, and if you're not doing them with the proper intention, then we are on our own. وَإِنْ يَخْذُلْكُمْ فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ إِنْ يَنْصُرُكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ. If Allah supports you, nobody can stop you. But if He abandon you, then go and find someone to support you. وَإِنْ يَخْذُلْكُمْ, if He abandons you, فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ, then you become on your own. Then it becomes balance of power. Those who plan, those who work hard, they will reap their fruits, Muslims or non-Muslims. Those who are not working hard, those who are not planning, those who are not serious will lag behind, Muslims and non-Muslims. So the questions that we are talking about are not subject of one khutbah or two or ten. Malik ibn Nabi, rahimahullah, great thinker, great Algerian thinker. He dedicated all his life and all his books to this question. Qadiyat Nahda, Renaissance. Why Muslim lagged behind? What does it take for them to rebound? All his life, that was his life mission. All his books are centered around this. Before the Prophet ﷺ, 13 years in Mecca doing what? 13 years in Mecca committing Muslims to the mission of Islam. There was no fiqh in Mecca. There was no rituals like prayers and fasting, none of this. There was no fiqh, there was no rituals. All of this came later in Medina. So what were Rasul ﷺ was teaching people? Rasul ﷺ was committing people to the mission and developing them into role models. People who can carry that mission, and people who can represent Islam in the best possible way. That's what he was doing. So if you are trying to do this week in and week out, and month in and month out, and year in and year out, it is not something that we are repeating. It is the heart of the matter that we have to be, not only in Jumu'ah, even when we get together, that should be the question. Why you ended up in this situation? What does it take to rebound? And conclude the discussion by asking yourself, what is it that I can do? Because we can talk theoretically about all the subjects in the world and do nothing about them. But then you have to conclude about what is it that I can do. So these are puzzling questions. This question that we are asking should not be taken normal. Muslims with this great faith, with this great history, with this large numbers everywhere, with this great resources should not be in this situation. Shouldn't. And actually, some comparison can make us very embarrassed. Because if you compare yourself as a billion and a half with some other nations who count by the millions, and then you compare the situation and where we are, we should be very embarrassed. And we should be very ashamed of ourselves. Does it mean that we give up hope? No. It's because we have hope that we're rejecting the situation. If we give up hope, we'll accept it. So when we talk about it and we say it is bad, and it is very bad, it's not like because we are pessimistic or because we are saying that it is hopeless. That's not true. If it is hopeless, we don't even talk about it. If it is hopeless, we're just going to accept it and be quiet. But because we're talking about it, because we know that we can and we should be better than this. And we know better than that. And we have been trying to look for the keys. What will turn things around? Yes, there is a lot of work that needs to be done, but you have to find the key to turn things around. And we came to two main keys. Without them, we are wasting our time. Without rediscovering the true Islam, the original, the genuine Islam, rediscovering it, yes, make an effort to rediscover that deen. And committing ourselves and our fellow Muslims to it as a life mission, to the mission of Islam and to its goals. We're going nowhere. Without this, we're going nowhere. That's the key. That's the first step. That's what is going to open the door and put us on track. When each one of us start making the effort to rediscover your faith, your original, the true, the one that was preached by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the one that created that great success story, the one that turned a group of Bedouins who were fighting each other all the time, poor, illiterate, small number, into leaders of the world and champions of great civilization. That's the Islam that we should be looking for. Not the Islam that is embraced by a billion and a half and did not make any difference. That's something else. They look very similar, but in appearance, in essence, they are very different. Proof, the results, the outcome. So rediscovering the true Islam and committing ourselves and our fellow Muslims to the mission of Islam and to the goals of Islam. Risalat al-Islam wa maqasid al-Islam. This deen came to achieve specific goals, big ones. We have to understand them and challenge ourselves to not only to do something or to contribute, to maximize our contribution towards these goals. And not to do something about our mission, but to do our best to fulfill our mission to the best of our ability. Add to that, part of the keys is to revive the true and original Tawheed, not the dry and complicated ones. There are so many definitions of Tawheed right out there. They're very dry, very superficial, very complicated, and useless. They don't produce anything. They get you into a lot of semantic and a lot of vocabulary, but does not produce the result. The real Tawheed is that vibrant relationship between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is based on a very on in-depth knowledge of Allah, the love of Allah, the gratitude, the tawakkul, when you start living with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time, and you're striving and you are so eager to do something that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the tawheed that we need to look for. Not the tawheed, the sentences and the phrases that we memorize. It's that tawheed that will produce the Rabbani, Muslim al-Rabbani, godly, the one who belongs to Allah. The one, when you see him, will remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So mission, maqasid, and tawheed. The engines that inshallah if we get them, if we can turn them on, will put us on track and we got us moving in the right direction, are some of them that we mentioned in the last few weeks. The engine of self-development, tazkiyah. Want to change the situation? Each one of us has to be in the business of self-development. Work on yourself. Work on yourself. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Make sure that every day you are a better person. Every day you learn something new and you do something more. You challenge yourself and push your limits. Imagine if that engine start moving, that every Muslim or many Muslims or majority of Muslims start to be in the business of self-development. We talked about marriage. Imagine that we fix that institution. We start establishing marriage on a very in a very systematic way. So we have many more successful marriages than failures. We may not have perfect record, but at least we have mostly or majority of marriages are functioning, happy, produce happy, coherent family. Why? Because it was done right, not haphazardly. People did not just get married haphazardly. That can help tremendously changing our situation if we start taking that institution seriously and start helping young generation to get married in a systematic way and maximize their chances of having a successful and happy marriage. The other should expect by now, third engine, is raising children. You want to change our situation? Start working to start raising your children in a different way. And make sure you focus on tarbiyah more than ri'aya. Tarbiyah, nurturing, mentoring, educating, etc. Ri'aya, taking care of the needs of your child. Most of us, we're doing only the second. We're doing very little when it comes to the first. Ri'aya. We're doing ri'aya, we're not doing tarbiyah. You're building that personality. That child, you're building him. You're going to plant principles, values, beliefs, character, etc. Ambition, resolve, so many things that you have to build in that personality. Imagine having successful families, succeeding in raising their children. That's the way. Without that, we can sit down and talk about all the political issues in the Muslim world and do nothing about it. That's where things start. Third engine. Number four. It is long overdue that we activate the engine of mentorship in our communities. Mentorship. Also translating to tazkiyah. By the way, that's one of the key elements in the job of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yuzakkihim wa yu'allimuhum kitaba wal hikmat. You want to be like the Prophet? You should be in the business of mentoring others and teaching. What is mentoring? Mentoring someone, meaning helping that person realize his potential, unlocking his potential. That's what mentoring is about. Trying to find the potential of that person and help that potential to come out. Because Allah creates people with tremendous potential, but that potential has to be cultivated and has to be unlocked to come out. This concept, some of you in corporations, in universities, in different places, they know that this is widely practiced. The concept of mentorship. Someone joins the company new, they assign someone to mentor that person. This is a pure Islamic principle, by the way. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, centuries ago, he used to do that. When someone comes to Islam, he assigned a mentor for him to bring him up to speed to the community. So it is not something that we're bringing from the moon, out of nowhere. It's a concept, it's a critical for our future generations. Because I, as I mentioned last time, your job as a parent with your children is limited as long as your child is young. Once your child becomes a teenager and beyond your ability or influence or control will be diminished. And of course, when he's 18, it's out. You are out of the picture because he can leave. He can just leave the house. So you have really no control anymore. If you want to enforce things, you can no longer do it. So what do we need at that time? Your child needs a mentor. You are his mentor and role model. You are his first mentor and his role model. And then when he grows up, he needs a mentor, someone who is older than him, but not much older. If your son is in high school, he needs a college student to mentor him. If your son is in college, he needs a young professional to mentor him, someone who has been through that. It is about time to implement a program of mentorship in our community so that we reestablish the generation continuum where every generation is working on the younger ones. So there will be no gap, no generation gap or breakdown. These are the engines that are going to put us in track. إن الله لا يغير ما بقوم حتى يغير ما بأنفسهم. That's Allah will not change the situation of people until they change themselves. That's how we change ourselves. Self-development, marriage and family, raising children, and mentorship. And it is never too late to activate any of these engines and make the necessary adjustments. Don't say it's too late for me because my children have grown up. Now we can work together on a mentorship program. Your marriage can be fixed and improved anytime. And we have younger generations who are going to get married. We can help them do it the right way. So there is no reason or no excuse for us to accept this reality to accept what's going on as our destiny or to accept reality as our destiny. Yes, there is a lot of learning that needs to be done. Absolutely. And there is a lot of work that needs to be done. Just show me any nation or community who took off without sacrifices and without a lot of work and a lot of dedication. There is nothing great in life that can be achieved without hard work and sweating and without sacrifice. So if I'm saying this and what comes to your mind, but that's too much to learn and too much to do, yes, it is too much. It's a lot to learn and there is a lot to do. Especially that we lagged behind for so long that now we have to catch up and make up for centuries of stagnation or centuries of actually moving backward. Because in this competitive world, if you are not moving forward, more than likely you are moving backward without even noticing. If you are not moving forward, because the world is moving, they're not waiting for us. So if we're not moving forward, more than likely we are moving backwards. What is going to fuel and motivate us, fuel those engines and motivate us to do all this work and all this learning? The two dreams we concluded with last time, if these are instilled in your mind all the time and in your hearts, that will keep you going. That's where you're going to get the energy and the motivation and the fuel. What are these two dreams? One is, أن تلقى الله وهو عنك راض. Don't take that for granted and don't underestimate this, the importance of this, because the stakes are very high. This is not something that you can take chance. I think Allah is pleased with me. I think I'm doing fine. I think I'm going to pass the test. You don't do that in a test in this life. You don't say, I think I understand the material. I think, no, you work so hard. And you work so hard until the last minute. So don't take that for granted, that you meet Allah and you find Him pleased with you and you are told that you made it, succeeded. That should be a dream that is always in your mind, but you should never take it for granted. It should be a dream that is always in your mind, but should never be taken for granted. And what is, because we don't know. None of us can be told where we stand now. So what is the solution? Solution is to work hard day in and day out to maximize your chances of succeeding. Because we cannot know the result now, that's the only thing we can do, is try to push myself and challenge myself to do more so that my chances will be bigger. I will have greater chances of succeeding. None of us is going to receive revelation in this life and be told that you made it or you are granted Jannah. None of us is min al-mubashirin bil-Jannah. Nobody. So that's the only thing we can do, is always, never settle for anything. Always challenge yourself and push your limits so that you maximize your chances of passing that test and meeting Allah while He's pleased with you. What's the second dream that will keep you going, which is very much related? You want Allah to be pleased with you, work in this life to fulfill the purpose of Allah. Try to understand the plan of Allah and execute it. What is it that Allah wants to happen on earth? You are two instruments in the hands of Allah to make it happen. Does Allah need your effort and my effort? Allah is free of all needs. غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ. Why? It's an honor that Allah has given us to be the one who execute his plan. It is a responsibility too. It's a great honor and great responsibility. And nobody is forced to do it. It's up to you. You want to seize the opportunity and grasp that honor, do it. You don't, it's up to you. Allah is not forcing any one of us to be working for Him or to be the ones who are executing His plan. Try to imagine, have a vision, a picture of this world in the sight of Allah, how Allah wants this world to be. And then work day in, day out, to close the gap between where we are and where we should be. That applies to yourself, always. Imagine the standard is whom? The standard is the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's your standard. So what you should be doing in this life? Trying to close the gap between you and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Hopefully, you get closer and closer. Your prayers and ibadat are being perfected. Your akhlaq are being perfected. Your character, your dedication to the cause of Allah and your contribution are being increased. Your leadership or the leadership model of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we as a community are implementing it and getting closer to it. That's what we should be doing. Closing the gap and having that as a vision. When you see this world where justice prevails, remember I have a dream? That's what every one of us should have, a dream. A dream that is, part of it is for yourself. Where do you want to see yourself? And work hard to turn that dream into reality and your family. And part of it is to your community and your society and the world at large. And then do as much as possible, push as much as you can to advance the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot change things by yourself. And Allah will not ask you to do more than what you can. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعى لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا ما أتاها. But Allah asks you to do everything you can. Every day you wake up, ask yourself this question: what is it that I can do today to just push the cause, advance the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if it is 1 inch. Push it. And what is it that I can do today to improve? And what is it that I can do to people around me to uplift them? That's the life of the believer, centered around these items and these concerns. What is it I can do to improve myself? What is it that I can do to people around me to uplift them? What is it that I can do to make this society and this world a better place, closer to the design of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And try every day to do, at least to keep what you have been doing, and hopefully to be able to do more. You're gonna have to remember that you are on a mission, and it is a huge one, and there is limited time to fulfill it, and the stakes are very high. So not only you have to do your best, and you have to fulfill this mission to the best of your ability, but also you have to have that sense of urgency, because the clock is ticking, and we're racing against the clock, and we never know when our time is going to be up, when we're going to be told, that's it, it's over, time is up. So we're racing against the clock. Do as much as you can while you can, and realize who you are and what is expected from you, what is your role in this life, what is your mission, and then try to live up to that. Live up to the divine mission, live up to the divine expectations, and live up to the title of being servant of Allah, follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and a Muslim. Wa tubu ilallahi inna ghafurur rahim. Inna alhamdulillahi nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nastahdihi wa natubu ilayhi. Na'udhu billahi min shurur anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdillahu fahuwa al-muhtad wa man yudlil falan tajid lahu waliyyan murshida. My dear respected brother and sister in Islam, when we go to sleep, there is some dhikr, and when we wake up, there is another dhikr. When we go to sleep, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if this is it, is to forgive us. Inna amsakta nafsi faghfir laha warhamha. Because it might be the end. Allahu yatawaffa al-anfusa hina mawtiha walati lam tamut fi manamiha. Fayumsiku allati qada alayha al-mawt wa yursilu al-ukhra ila ajalin musamma. Now we die every night. We die every night. And then some people come back, and some people, this is it. That's what the verse says. Verse in Surah Al-Zumur. الله يتوفى الأنفس حين موتها والتي لم تمت في منامها فيمسك التي قضى عليها الموت ويرسل الأخرى. So some people are going to be retained, and others will be sent back to their due date or time. Why are you saying that? Normally this should come out of that. This normally should come out of feeling of shortcoming, that maybe this day I didn't do enough. So in amsakta nafsi faghfir laha warhamha. Maybe I did not live up to your expectations. So if this is the end, please, oh Allah, forgive me. Forgive me and have mercy on me. That should come out of feeling of shortcoming, that maybe I didn't do the job, or more than likely I didn't do the job as I supposed to. Like when we finish praying. As soon as we finish praying, we make istighfar. Many of us, we do istighfar, we don't know why. But that istighfar, that's what it's meant to be. You're making istighfar feeling that your prayer was not really good enough to be presented to Allah. And basically, implicitly, you are making commitment that the next prayer, inshallah, you're going to work harder or try harder. But unfortunately, the only thing that is left is istighfar. We do it without those feelings. But that's where it should come from. And then when you wake up in the morning, there is also dhikr of renewing your commitment and your pledge to Allah. There is even shahada. Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa alayhi an-nushur. And then ashhadu anna Allah yuhyi al-mauta wa annahu ala kulli shay'in qadir. Ashhadu anna Allah yuhyi al-mauta wa annahu ala kulli shay'in qadir. It's another way to start your day, that you're resuming that job. You took that break, you're resuming. Even before you go to your daily job, you're resuming your job with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The moment you wake up, you resume that job, and you renew your commitment and your pledge to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is that job that you start as soon as you wake up? Is to strive to understand and fulfill the purpose of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I'm gonna do my best today to have better understanding of Allah's plan and Allah's purpose, and then do probably try harder to execute it and to make it happen. How? Again, by learning more and doing more. Always. If you forget everything else, keep these. Challenge yourself daily to learn something new and to do more fi sabilillah, in the service of the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, what can I do to improve myself? What can I do to advance the cause of Allah? What I can do to help people around me, uplifting people around me? This is the life of the believers. That's what should be preoccupying you all the time. Inshallah, next time if we have a chance, we'll talk about what is preventing us from doing this and how we can overcome. There are minor obstacles that are here, mindsets that we have to fix so that inshallah we can unlock our potential and we can do the job as expected. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم اشف مرضانا وارحم موتانا وتوفنا وانت راض عنا واختم بالصالحات أعمالنا واجعل خير أعمالنا خواتمها وخير أيامنا يوم نلقاك. ومتعنا اللهم بالنظر إلى وجهك الكريم. ربنا ارحم والدينا كما ربونا صغارا وارحم موتانا وجميع موتى المسلمين. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. صلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وأقم الصلاة.